it is like literally the hottest part of the day, and I come over here to cut some timber because, one, I'm an idiot, and two, I get bored sitting around, so I try to stay busy. But one thing I wanted to show everybody real quick was this is where we cut last week. You kind of see our log road here. One thing I wanted to kind of touch on right here, we got a walnut tree, got a walnut tree, got a walnut tree, and one we cut. Now, out of these three walnut trees still here remaining, they could be cut. They absolutely could be cut. They are big enough to take to market, and a lot of people would cut trees that size. They're right there on that 11 to 12 inch range. I don't like to cut trees that small generally if we don't have to. It's one thing if it's a clearing project. It's another thing if it's a piece of property that's not going to be sold anytime in the near future that the client plans on keeping. So what I like about trees like this is going through here like we have and just kind of doing a light harvest. So you can see the other bur oak there we cut. There's a road that kind of snakes on around. These trees, you know, in a few years, they will be of a good size to harvest. And especially these two out here. Now, this one's kind of on the fringe here of this road. So he's got some more low-lying limbs and a few knots on him. So it'll still make a good lumber log one of these days. But these trees here growing in the timber, in the forest like this, notice how clean they are. Let's zoom in a little bit. Notice how clean they are growing up through there. No knots, no branches, no limbs. Just good, clean trees growing up through there. Some of them got a little bit of a crook to them, but that's okay. Down the road, these will be exceptional trees. Exceptional trees. And one thing that bugs me to death is some people, when they go in and log a piece of property, I mean, they absolutely mutilate the timber stand. Absolutely just mutilate it. That's one thing I can't stand seeing because you're kind of slitting your own throat. You're hurting your client and you're hurting yourself. Now, there's no guarantee that we'll be the ones that cut these trees in the future. Absolutely no guarantee at all. There's another tree right there, a good walnut growing through there. And there's several good walnut growing through this track of timber, this little stretch here, down this little ditch, this little draw, getting a lot of water, a lot of runoff. But again, it's just about good stewardship and good forest management practices. And I enjoy getting to come through here when a client hires us to manage their timber. And that's really what we do. Yeah, we harvest timber, but at the same time, I like to think of what we do as managing timber as well. So when we come through here, the client is putting their trust in us to take care of their timber. And I try to do the best of our abilities. And one thing I'm really proud of is I'm getting to the age now, and I've done it long enough, that I am starting to go back on a lot of the same farms that we've cut before, that my dad's cut before. And it's always great to see that when you go through here and you can hand pick some of these trees to leave behind, go through, take out your better trees, some of your trees that have some health problems, thin them out, open up your canopy, your treetops here, let that sunlight come in, give these smaller trees a chance to grow. Then down the road, you've got another good crop of trees. And it's just a reoccurring cycle. And that's the great thing about forest management. That's one thing I really love about this job. It's just to see it. It's farming in a sense. You know, it's even though we are trying to be good stewards of the land, we're harvesting timber. It really is going through here, taking care of the timber, seeing things improve for the better, and knowing that our client and ourselves are going to have something to look forward to in the future. That's one thing I really enjoy about going through here and doing selective harvesting practices, especially with the walnut, the bur oak, the maple, the ash, the sycamore. It's just, I love getting to work in the hardwood timber stands like this. Right there, right through the middle there. Another good walnut right there growing. Just a good little bunch of trees growing down this ditch. And like I said, down the road here, give these trees 10 years and they're going to be something. They really will. And some of them less than that. You give this little track of timber 10 years, there's going to be a heck of a stand of trees here in 10 years' time. Something to look forward to. Because I still plan on being around doing this in 10 years. So hopefully, if the farm doesn't change hands and We're going to come back and do it again. That's part of the thing about it. I love developing long-term relationships with clients. I want to manage their timber as long as we can. My family's managed a lot of the same farms for years and years and years. We've a lot of century farms that we've managed. My dad's cut on the same track now, some of them 5 and 6 times. Tracks that his dad cut on. And it's great to know that I can come along and cut on the same tracks because my granddad and my dad managed the timber properly. And they, I mean, that's where I learned it from. That's who taught me. He's watching my dad all these years. So that's one thing I'm especially proud of. We'll go over here. I don't know if I'm going to drag any today, especially like I said, in this blistering heat, but there's some walnut down here in the lower end. I want to try to get some of them cut, and I felt kind of like an idiot driving over here because I'm like, gosh, dang, it's hot, you know, bumping on 97, 98 degrees, you know, right here in the midst of summer. But I'm going to unload the Ranger. I'm going to go down here on this lower end, and there's some walnut I want to try to get on the ground. And like I said, I might go ahead and drag them out this evening. I don't know yet. Haven't made up my mind on that. But it's part of it's just feeling productive, feeling like I've done something today. So we'll gas up. We'll go down there and try to lay some trees on the ground. Saturday morning here in the timber, dragging out some of this maple I've cut during the week. I'm actually back here to where in the last video where we broke the main line. So I'm going to go ahead and unhook these chokers. Dad's actually on the little 440 this morning. Obviously he's not dragging anything, but he's on the other side of the place over here. He's cutting some of the bigger walnut this morning because, you know, Dad likes to cut the cream, which I can't say is that I blame him. But I'm trying to finish up some of this maple I've got cut in through here. Kind of scattered about. I think I'm kind of on the downhill slide of it. I think I got 3 or 4 more out through here, a couple here. And then there's some hackberry and stuff on up the other end. Now, there's a lot of good young maple growing in here. And this maple grows pretty fast. It's a pretty fast-growing wood, the soft maple we have here in southwest Missouri, eastern Kansas. So, just like most of the time when we do a harvest, I like to go in here and just kind of thin it. Not get too carried away, but some things you got to look for in some of these swampy areas. You can see that there, but also kind of look at this here, which... if I was a little stronger, I might be able to push this over. Oh, she's popping. She's popping. Come on. Timber. Look at that. Brute force. Anyway, yeah, so this stuff grows pretty fast. I love cutting the maple timber. I really do. It can be kind of tricky and dangerous to cut because it seems like these things always grow crooked and oblong. So it's usually they have a lot of weight to one side or the other, and they're pretty brittle. They bust easy, so... it's always essential to get that heartwood cut out really well. I mean, you don't want to leave a lot of hold wood around that heart. Of course, you never do, but I just, they always kind of make me nervous. I've got a lot of respect for maple when I cut them. So we'll see if we can get this stuff out and get to the deck. Kevin's working the deck. Dad's cutting. Hopefully, we'll have a good day. Some bucking here. Dad said he cut some decent walnut and bur oak this morning, but he said I would have to go around to drag him out because where he crossed, he said there's no way that 548 would go through there, and he said he really didn't think we'd be able to drag him through there at the 440, so we'll have to go back and around. I just ran out of gas, so I'm refilling. This is one of Dad's saws here I'm using. 404 chain on it. Dad likes the 404 chain. I'll say this about it. I think it's a more hardy chain. I think it'll take more abuse. Of course, you can see Dad's chain's in a full skip where I just run a semi-skip chain. Here's something like one of my chains. Actually, this is one of my chains. This is a RS36 and a square tooth and a 3/8 gauge chain. I like the square tooth chain for bucking, cutting in river bottoms. I think it'll cut longer, especially in the dirty trees. Dad runs a round tooth chain on his 404. The round tooth, I will say this, for boring walnut and boring trees, I think it's a lot easier to bore with. The square chain's like it wants to push out. Here in a minute, I'll show you why I'm not using my saw to buck with. I'm not too happy with myself, but... had a little mishap. I always keep my saw on the back of the skidder right there, kind of behind the winch underneath the cylinders. And it's something you got to really watch for when you're dragging logs, getting on inclines, because it will slide off. And that's exactly what happened. And I was more focused on trying to grab logs than I was paying attention to the saw. So it's a dumb error on my part, but things like that happen. But you still hate to see it happen. So Brandon, he doesn't know it yet, but he probably will when he watches this video. He's going to be doing some welding on these skidders, because I'm not going to have that happen anymore. So we're going to devise something we can weld up there, maybe a lip or something on the, well, that'll sit up just a little higher to keep things sliding off. So that's going to be an upcoming project for sure for all these machines, because there's nothing more frustrating than something happening to your saw and damaging it like that. Now, luckily, I didn't break the case on it. Just busted the handle and bent the bar a little bit, which it was my steel light bar, which those are a little more expensive bars than the regular bars like this, just the regular old steels, which honestly, that was my first one. I don't know if there's a whole lot of difference there that I can tell as far as weight reduction. I mean, I know there is, but as far as being able to tell, I don't really know. So I don't want to tell you if they're really worth spending the extra money for those light bars or not. That's really, I couldn't tell you if it's a good investment or not. One of the big things, the reason I bought it, they said they were a little more durable and strong, so that kind of interested me a little bit. So, but I don't know, it's definitely bent, which when you run over something with a skidder, you're gonna bend it. I'm gonna tighten this chain. I'm gonna go back to bucking, then I'll show you guys my big mess up for the day. All right, the moment you've been waiting for. Good job, me. You know, I don't mind showing you guys some of my mess ups, because they happen. I mean, it doesn't matter what profession you're in or what you do or how long you've been doing it. You just hope that you can learn from it and not do it again, or be a little more careful. And obviously, when it first happened, I had a few choice words that I wasn't going to say on the video. I might have had several said choice words, but I was more so mad at myself for allowing it to happen. But like I said, the actual engine and the case are in pretty good shape. Chain brakes broke, of course. Handles broke. We're a little bent down here on this, but I think we can replace this right here. You can see these screws. We'll replace those. Like I said, my claws are bent, which we've got a lot of extra stuff like that laying around. These can be bent back, these claws. So bent my bar, which that kind of upsets me, that light bar. Like I said, those things they're pretty expensive compared to the regular ones. I think we're paying around maybe $75 for a regular bar, I think. Don't hold me to that, but I know for a fact I gave $144 for these light bars. And I've actually got another one of these light bars, but for a 50 gauge application. So yeah, that's yay me, huh? It happens. It's not the first time I've done it, and I promise you it won't be the last. If somebody says they've never torn anything up or never broke anything or had any screw-ups, then they probably haven't been logging that long, or just kind of hobby log, and even then they're probably more prone to it than we are. So that's that. I'm going to unhook the pinel hitch right here. I've got the jacks down. I'm going to dolly it down. Just leave it right here in the way. I'm going to round Kevin up here in a second. Dad's already, he's headed in. He actually, I think he's going to go see about another job of timber. He's been buying a lot of timber up over here lately. So he kind of gets the fever every now and then. He likes to keep things rolling. It's good. I sleep better at night knowing we got a big bunch of timber ahead of us to cut. We could only get some cooler weather and maybe a little shower to kind of kill this dust. I'd be a lot happier. Definitely some cooler weather. Fall can't get here soon enough. I hate summer. I hate everything about it. It is not logging weather, but we have to continue to log day in, day out, every chance we get. So, short video today, guys. Thank you all for watching, though. I'll try to be a little better about posting videos. I know I've been slacking on it here lately. I get that way sometimes. So I'll try to be a little better about getting stuff posted up in a timely manner and more often. Thank you guys for watching. Hey guys, if you like what you see, be sure to like, comment, and subscribe to our channel for all of our latest videos.